Welcome to the first Sunday after Jesus Christ Superstar. I think we'll be referring to time as before Jesus Christ Superstar and after Jesus Christ Superstar. So this is it. And it's the second Sunday of Easter. Thank you all for coming. Thank you all who are tuning in at home on your computers, iPads, on WSUMC. Thank you everyone for being here. Let's start the service with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we celebrate Easter once again, as we have for 2,000 years, for the resurrection of your Son, precious gift to us. You also brought to us the Holy Spirit, who abides with us always, the Advocate. Please let us tune in to the Advocate today. In the words of the hymns, words of the choir, and from Pastor Keith. Amen.
You may be seated. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter to you.
I've always taught that every Sunday is Easter because every Sunday is a worship and a celebration of the resurrection. But that said, every day for us is Easter because every day is a day for the risen Lord. Although I think Sarah back there was thinking that when we sing like on Palm Sunday, waving the palms, I think she liked that so much that she's just going to do that every Sunday. So I don't know if you saw her, she's back there waving her arms around. That's not a bad idea for all of us, is it? So as we continue our worship, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God as we are in post-Superstar and a little kind of hungover from the energy and the exhaustion of all of that. I was amazed to see GJ here this morning. I'm amazed to see Sam this morning, you know. And yet, it was one of those wonderful blessings where just what God was doing gave us energy as we were doing it, too. So as we take the offering, here's a message for us to watch.
Good morning, Stewartstown United Methodist Church. This is Dave McDowell.
And GJ Emge.
And we both look pretty rough, because we have just finished Jesus Christ Superstar, including all the sets right. 3 years ago, I challenged you to step out of the comfort zone and try something different to reach the community for Christ, and you did. And it's with heartfelt thanks that I thank you for all the people that came out in all the many ways during the process and to conclude it with the rigging and the striking. Without your help, 40 to 45 people some days, we couldn't have done what we did.
The thing is, it's not over. We've really just started. The challenge that's before us now is continue reaching out to the community, continue to engage people in meaningful ways, continue to support and develop new small group ministries. The show was simply a catalyst. It was a way to connect with people, a way to open people's eyes to the church, doing something a little bit different. Now our challenge is to continue to do something different, to continue to seek to connect with those who do not know Christ, those who are separated from the church, those who have been hurt by the church. And as I thank you for everything that you guys offered, I want to challenge you and encourage you to continue what we have started. Look for ways to connect with your neighbor, connect with that stranger, and invite them into the love that is Christ's love.
And now we're both going to take a long nap. See you.
One of the joys of coming together as a community is just to be able to share our life together and what is happening in our lives, the things that we're rejoicing in, our joys, but also our concerns, our burdens that we share with one another and that we lift up to God. So what are those prayer requests, joys, concerns, and things we would like to lift up to God today?
Yes. A friend named Ed, who has an important job interview this week, he said we would pray for him.
Pray for Ed, with an important job interview this week.
Jean? Yeah, our daughter actually just got a job offer that she was really hoping and praying for, so she's very, very excited.
Excited about a new job possibility, new job offer. Excellent. So, yeah, Sam? For the Aponte family at the death of Caleb. Yeah. So. Joe?
Prayers for the family of Bill, who was in the hospital of Grayson.
Okay. So we've been praying for Grayson, and we continue to ask for prayers for Grayson. But while Grayson was in the hospital, they became friends with a family named Dylan. The young man's named Dylan, but Dylan died. So again, prayers for this family again in the loss of a child. Prayers for the Wolf family in the passing of Jim Wolf this past week on Friday. So Jim was the brother of Susan and Ginger and the Wolf family and the son of George. And so keep that family in your prayers. There will be a service for Jim here in the sanctuary Wednesday. I think the public viewing is from 3 until 6. The service is at 6. No, service is at 5. Anyway, we'll get the word out to you. So prayers for them. Others? Janice? Oh, outstanding. Yes. Congratulations on the celebration of 30 years, and Janice is bootless. So, yes, Aaron. Spring 23, so outstanding. Prayers for our sister Vicky. Vicky has pneumonia, which is not good given her general health. Prayers for Connie and for Aaron. So this week Aaron had COVID. He was very sick for a while. He's recovering, thankfully. Connie's back is hurt, and I'm not sure when she's going to be back. So prayers for Connie for the healing, too. Yes, Al.
I'd like to ask for prayers for Carol Netlin. She had cataract surgery, and it went very well, but now she's having a difficult time recovering. And I was talking to her yesterday, and she said they're talking about a negative surgery.
For Carol Nepley, who's recovering from cataract surgery, and there might be some complications there, so prayers for healing. Prayers for Janet, as Janet has a pretty significant surgery tomorrow, and just ask that you remember to, we will pray for you today, but also remember tomorrow, and for Pat, too, because he's going to be a mess. We just know he is. So. Karen. New grandson, Caden David Colmer. Yes. Esther.
Prayers for Barb Spurlock. She goes in Wednesday for what they call watchman. She goes in for a watchman field. I had it done last month. She's going in that.
Okay. So prayers for Barb as she goes through this procedure. Yes. Prayers also for Doug Matthews as he continues to recover and hopefully getting better. So is Doug home?
He's home.
He's home now.
He's in rehab.
Oh, okay. He's still at Spirit Trust. Yeah, yeah. So, others. Then musically and just in these moments, let's prepare ourselves for a time of prayer. Lord, we thank you and praise you. You have asked us to do the impossible, things that can be done only as you make them possible. And we thank you, Lord, for just the privilege of working with you and for you and giving you glory in these past weeks through this incredible effort. We thank you for the lives of those who were touched. We thank you for the family that was built among the cast and the crew and all of those who worked together. We thank you, Lord, for the evidence of what your people can be and what they can do when they come together in community for a purpose. So we thank you for our Stewartstown United Methodist Church experience of building an ark, our experience of like in the Amish raising a barn, our experience of what you can do in us and through us. Lord, as we're in the aftermath of that, we ask that you would continue to inspire us and to move us to realize that big things can be taken on as you break them up for us into small things that can be accomplished, that these relationships have been built, continue. And for the small groups and for the efforts of the congregation to continue to connect with our neighbors, again, building community around our purpose, a purpose you have given to us through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for the joy that you give us in our lives, for new opportunities like jobs, for new babies born into families, for engagements and new marriages that are coming up, for the relief from opportunities for healing, for just the so many things, Lord, that we can give you thanks for. You have created us. You provide for us. And we have these moments of joy, Lord, in your presence with things that you have accomplished in our lives that are far beyond our ability. Even in our brokenness, Lord, we recognize your healing power, your forgiveness, and your ability to turn that which is seemingly irredeemable or unfixable to bring your healing power. And for all of those that we have mentioned here and also others that we have mentioned in our hearts, may your healing power and your presence be present. You, Lord, are the great healer. And so we thank you and praise you in advance for what you are already doing in the lives of people that need your healing touch. Lord, we lift up to you those that mourn this day for just losses. Lord, that there are some losses that just seems you never get over, but you learn to live with, especially the loss of a child, whether that child was a young child or whether your child dies before you, even in older age. So we pray for the Wolf family, for Caden's family, for Dylan's family. We pray for all of those that have been experiencing loss and pray, Lord, for your comfort, for your hope. We thank you, Lord, that we can grieve as people with hope because you have decided that death will not have the last word. So we praise you and thank you and place in you our trust and our faith through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is from the letter of the Apostle John. I'm not sure if I'm going to have the same version that's up on the screen, so just figure it out. Interestingly, John starts off with first person plural, and there's really no obvious explanation for this, just the device he uses, and then he switches back to first person singular for the second chapter. Here is what we announced to everyone about the Word of Life. The Word was already here from the beginning. We have heard him. We have seen him with our eyes. We have looked at him. Our hands have touched him. This life has appeared. We have seen him. We are witnesses about him, and we announce to you the same eternal life. He was already with the Father. He has appeared to us. We announce to you what we have seen and heard. We do it so you can share life together with us. And we share life with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing this to make our joy complete. Here is a message we have heard from him and announced to you. God is light. There is no darkness in him at all. Suppose we say that we share life with God, but still walk in the darkness. Then we are lying. We are not living out the truth. But suppose we walk in the light, just as he is in the light. Then we share life with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, makes us pure from all sin. Suppose we claim we are without sin, then we are fooling ourselves. The truth is not in us, but God is faithful and fair. If we confess our sins, he will forgive our sins. He will forgive every wrong thing we have done. He will make us pure. If we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar. His word is not in us. Dear children, I'm writing this to you so that you will not be in sin. But suppose someone does sin. Then we have a friend who speaks to the Father for us. He is Jesus Christ, the blameless one. He gave his life to pay for our sins. But he not only paid for our sins, he also paid for the sins of the world. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Just want to say something about the paintings that are around. If you went to Superstar, you saw that there was a variety of paintings that were around the tent that were made for that purpose. We'll swap out some so we can see them and use them. But this one in particular seemed to be particularly appropriate for the sermon series, talking about Jesus and Jesus now. One of the questions that Superstar asked, but one of the questions is always before us, is who is this Jesus? We can't escape him, the inescapable man. Jesus has come up throughout the ages. You can basically make the argument that of any person in history, that Jesus has had more of an impact upon human history than in any other person. So the question before us is, who is Jesus? But it's not just a matter of, you know, intellectually thinking about all these different pieces of who Jesus is. The real question is, who is Jesus to you? Not just who is Jesus, but who is Jesus to you? It's kind of like as Jesus turned to his followers and said, who do people say that I am? And then, who do you say that I am? Because Jesus is so pivotal that how you answer that question has an implication to determine every part of your life. But in order for us to understand how that's possible, you have to really explore a little bit more who Jesus is. And I realize that there have been different times in my life that I've tried to put Jesus in a box, fit him into a first century setting. You heard me say a couple weeks ago, you know, ask the question, do you think Jesus could drive a car, or do you think Jesus could operate a computer? And as a teenager, I remember thinking, nah, you know, and then it's like, well, yeah, because not only be able to do them, probably can do them better than anybody else ever, and make them capable of doing things that we didn't even imagine. So we kind of put Jesus in the box. So we have Jesus in these pictures that we have. So we have the baby Jesus at Christmas time, and then we have Jesus at the temple as a boy, and then we have the to Jesus as he's going through his ministry, teaching and healing and doing those different things. But Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, is so much more. So much more. So I want to give you a couple of thoughts or perspectives about that. And one of the pieces of this, as I prepared this sermon, is that there's no way for me to do any kind of comprehensive description of who Jesus is. There are so many different elements of it, so many different angles on it. It's like a diamond has very many facets, and you can see it from different sizes. This has almost an infinite number of facets, like every individual person. Because who Jesus is, and as you answer that question, Jesus is going to be slightly different to each of us, depending upon as God meets us, where we are. And it's really not, again, an intellectual description or a scriptural description about who Jesus is. It's really about the only way to know who Jesus is a personal relationship. Is a personal relationship. Because the living Word of God is not this. It's not the Bible. This is not the living Word of God. The living Word of God is Jesus Christ. Harold Beck was a seminary professor, and one of the things that he was famous for saying is that he wished that when we published Bibles, we'd publish them without a back cover. Because we act as if God's speaking to us, God's Word in our presence, in our midst, ended with the end of the book of Revelation, rather than continuing on into the lives of God's people, because Jesus Christ, the living Word of God, is living in us. So let's take Jesus out of that first century box. The other box I often thought about is that Jesus is part of the Trinity. Jesus is part of the Godhead. Jesus is part of the One that is constantly in relationship. And yet, somewhere in my head, it's almost like Jesus didn't exist until it was time for him to be born. It's like, oh, now we need to have God in the flesh, and so now Jesus. Here the scripture is saying that Jesus is there with God, is God, from the very beginning. John's gospel, and this is John's epistle, but John's gospel starts out with, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, in the beginning, and that everything was made through Jesus. So that Christ, as part of the Trinity, as part of God, has always existed. Has always existed. There was never a time when Jesus Christ did not exist. And everything was made through Christ and is sustained in Christ. So that other part of it is to say that this Jesus who appeared at birth, who died, was buried, rose again, ascended into heaven, and we think about that's the drama. But no, this is the eternal Christ. The eternal Christ. The eternal Word of God. The other part of it is that in terms of the expression of who God is, Jesus Christ taking human flesh taught us everything that we need to know, at least in that form, about God. You want to know who God is? You look at Jesus Christ. You want to know what the ideal humanity is? You look at Jesus Christ. So you have Jesus Christ, who is the eternal God, one and in relationship. Let me say something more about that. That God is within the Trinity, is in relationship constantly. One God in relationship. We are made in God's image. Isn't the whole purpose of everything related to Jesus Christ to bridge that gap between us and God, so that as God is in God's self is one and constantly in relationship, that the natural way for us to be is to be connected to God as one in relationship with God and with one another. And all of this, again, is accomplished through Jesus Christ. Even more than that, John says that, and here it says, that Jesus is the Word of God, the Logos of God. Logos is the Greek word for word. So what is word? Logos, it's language, it's communication, it's information. And one of the things that we find is that when you look at the nature of reality, there's so much of nature of reality that has to do with information. DNA, at its heart, is basically information. It's a string of proteins that organizes all life. And when you change the program, you change the entity that is built out of that. So at its heart, life itself is information. Can't get into it too much this morning, and maybe I'm touching on it too much already. When you get into physics and the nature of reality itself, we're finding out that so much of the nature of reality itself is basically information. I don't know about you, but like I was old school. Man, I still believe that the matter was made up of atoms that were protons and neutrons and electrons. And now I'm finding out that those are made of smaller particles that are made of smaller particles. And then you get down to the quantum level. And at the quantum level, things get really weird. Because apparently the nature of matter and reality itself can be influenced by intention and thought. So that what you believe changes the nature of reality itself. So Jesus Christ as the Logos of God, the Word of God, if you will, the information of God, is not only part of God, but Jesus Christ is the organizing principle of the universe. Where did it come from? Where is it going? Jesus Christ. How is it organized? Jesus Christ. All the elements of it, the light, the darkness, the death, the resurrection, every piece of the pattern of God's plan and God's kingdom is based and grounded in the nature of reality itself, which is best understood as Jesus Christ. And that's why we also have said that the way then to understand things is that if Christ is the focus, if the Christ is the inclusion of everything, then everything in the scriptures is about and points to Jesus Christ. So the best way then to understand the scripture is through the lens of who Christ is. And you've heard me say before that like you can go to the scriptures and you can defend genocide, but you can also see clearly the incredible inclusion and honoring of all people. But only one of those attitudes is Christ-like. You can go to the scriptures and you can justify slavery. You can also see the breaking of bonds and the freeing of people. But only one of those attitudes is Christ-like. You can see in the scriptures it's the subjugation of women, and you can see women lifted up to be equal partners with men and to be leaders, but only one of those attitudes is Christ-like. Why? We're looking at this through the lens of Jesus Christ. So this Jesus is not just born, lived, healed, taught, died, buried, rose again. The entire nature of our lives and reality itself is meant to be grounded in Christ, informed by Christ, surrounded by Christ. I love the St. Patrick's breastplate, the prayer, and I'm not going to get it right off the top of my head, but it's basically, you know, Christ go before you to show you the way, and Christ be behind you to protect you, and Christ be at your right hand and at your left hand. Christ be above you. Christ be below you. Christ be in your interaction with every human being. Christ be in your words. Christ be in your seeing. All of it is around and about Jesus Christ. It's Christ is all-encompassing. And it's designed, life in Christ, is designed to be the life that we live. So who is Jesus Christ to you? According to the scriptures, the way that it comes out, it's basically all or nothing. All-encompassing, touching and informing and shaping and sustaining every part of our lives as we are open to belief and faith that who Christ is and what Christ is doing in our life changes everything and makes a difference. So if Jesus is a nice stories, if he's a wise guide, and even if we say that Jesus is our Savior, you know, that we are saved by what Jesus did on the cross, and that's the only thing we hold on to Jesus, you know, every part of it is enough. But that's still limiting everything that has to do with Christ. Because we can say, Christ died for my sins, I am now cleansed by the blood of Christ, and then boom, you know, I'm in turn. But the goal is, in our lives, as followers of Jesus Christ, is that God in us, Christ living in us, as Paul says, it's no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me, is so much bigger and more powerful and all-encompassing than anything else we can imagine. At the very end of the book of Revelation, when Christ appears, he's talking to John, he identifies himself and says, I am the first and I am the last. That's the Alpha, the Omega, the origin and the destiny and everything in between. Who is Jesus Christ to you? Can you understand how the way you answer that question can define every facet of your life? And if you don't answer the question, then you've answered the question. Lord, we thank you that you loved us enough to create us, that you, by your will, by your power, by your word, you sustain us, that you call us to be organized according to the justice and the fairness and the love and the grace of your kingdom, all made possible not only through what Jesus Christ has done, his life and death and resurrection, but by the sustaining presence of Christ in us, through us, with us, in whom we live and move and have our being. Lord, we thank you that Christ is like water is to a fish, like air is to a bird, like life-giving light for us. We thank you and praise you. We believe, Lord, help our unbelief. We try to limit you, Lord, help us to break outside of those limits and to be completely open, empty to be filled by Christ and Christ alone. Amen. Okay, I have to say, the choir just proved my point. Because I had no idea what that anthem was until just now. Just think about that. Yeah, I had no idea that that's what they were going to be singing. And yet, God plans better than we can.
We changed it after you said that.
Yeah.
It was going to be good night to rain. So, let us stand. I usually say, go forth and serve God, your neighbor, and all that you do. It's as we have been challenged. GJ challenged on the video, we've challenged to connect with one another. And there's something about the St. Patrick's prayer that also has something to do with that. So Christ be with me, let's make it. Christ be with you, Christ within you, Christ behind you, Christ before you, Christ beside you, Christ to win you, to comfort and restore you. Christ beneath you, Christ above you. Christ in quiet, Christ in danger. Christ in hearts of all that love you. And here's the one that jumps out at me.
Christ in mouth, of friend and stranger. Remember when Jesus said, when you do it for the least of these, you've done this unto me? Consider the possibility that every encounter you have with friend or stranger is the presence of Christ. Look for Christ, and you will find Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace.